determine what goes on. There's very little opportunity for the church to operate autonomously. So it's a very top-down. Their clergy are even appointed by bishops. So like I said, that's a very top-down. So if we go to the opposite end, we go to the churches that are completely independent. Those would be the congregational churches. They have local leadership. Their doctrine is based on the individual church. They have their own bylaws. Their clergy are elected by the church. And they are very autonomous. Most Baptist churches are congregational. The Church of Christ, the Disciples of Christ are all congregational churches. Then there's us. We're kind of in the middle. We are part of the Presbyterian mode of government. There's shared leadership from the top and from the bottom. One of the things I love about the Wesleyan Church is that we're realizing that, you know what, some of the best stuff out there doesn't need to be created by headquarters because there are local churches that are already doing it. And so they are making resources available for us. That's what I love about living in the age that we live in. They can have repositories available, and we download it, and other churches have already done it, and they're not charging for it, which is awesome stuff. Our doctrines are based on our articles of faith. The clergy are elected by you. You elect your pastor, but they are approved by our district. And you can see that the Wesleyans, the Nazarenes, the Christian Missionary Alliance, Presbyterians obviously would be in that Presbyterian mode. Churches that do the Episcopal mode of government, I forgot, Roman Catholic, Anglican, and the Methodists. Both the Free Methodists and the United Methodists use that type of government. So those are our governments. And just like our government here in our country is divided into three levels, our church government is divided into three levels. There is the local church, which is us. We are the local church. And we have we call this a local church conference. And once a year, probably about May, it's coming up, we will have a local church conference. Occasionally, we have an additional church conference because we have to elect a new pastor or something like that. And the church is governed by the local board of administration and the pastor. Pretty simple. And then we send on delegates to the district conference. The district conference has a district board of administration. It has a district superintendent. We also meet once a year up near Buffalo. We are governed by the district board of administration and the district superintendent. Our district superintendent is Dr. Joey Jennings. And we are in the Western New York district. And our district board also meets. It is a equal representation. We talked about this, equal representation of lay people and ministerial members. And they meet regularly during the year. And our district headquarters is in Eden, New York. We do have an annual camp meeting, which I really encourage you to attend. It's at Houghton College on July 30th through August 4th. And we already have the dates for that. So that's kind of cool. And then there is the general level. Our general superintendent is Dr. Wayne Schmidt. He's right there. Pastored for many years in Kentwood, just outside of Grand Rapids, Michigan. We have a general conference made up of equal numbers of laity and ministerial members. We talked about that. We have a general board that's also made up of an equal number of ministerial and lay. The general conference meets how often? Every 4 years. Every 4 years. We just met in Buffalo last year. And we have a general board of administration, general superintendent, and our headquarters, our publishing house, is located in beautiful Fishers, Indiana. Actually, it's almost become a city of itself. We were there probably, 10, 20 years ago now? And it was out in the middle of the cornfield. It's no longer the middle of a cornfield. It's a city of its own now. We have five colleges. One of those is a liberal arts that's right in our area. Our local college is Houghton College. Go Highlanders. James is one of those Highlanders. And I know we have several other alumni and kids who are alumni. We have a Bible college as well that's located in Sussex, New Brunswick. It's Kingswood University, formerly Bethany Bible College. Then we have three more liberal arts universities. My alma mater, Indiana Wesleyan University in Marion, Indiana. We have Southern Wesleyan University, which would be Anna's alma mater. We kind of like spread it around, didn't we? And then we have Oklahoma Wesleyan University out in Bartlesville, Oklahoma. And I do want to mention that Pam is a graduate of one of our Wesleyan colleges. She graduated from United Wesleyan College in Allentown, but she's kind of considered an alumnus of Houghton. So that's how that all works. Sometimes I do get questions, and you might get questions. They say, hey, I heard about this Wesleyan University in Connecticut, or I heard about this Virginia Wesleyan, or I heard about Illinois Wesleyan. Those are not part of us. So if you hear weird things coming out of Wesleyan universities in other parts of the country, they're not us. Sometimes they are colleges that were originally started by the Methodist Church, but the Methodist Church has a different way of dealing with their colleges than we do. The Wesleyan Church has a firm hand on our colleges, and so our colleges don't get off into strange theology and all that good stuff. So those other colleges are primarily what they are, Methodist colleges, and I'm sure if John Wesley knew that his name was attached to those Wesleyan colleges, he would be rolling over in his grave. Unfortunately, there's not much Wesleyan left in a lot of those other Wesleyan colleges. So, question for you. Who or what should come up on the screen? Should be the ultimate authority in the church? And how do we hear from God?
His word.
There you go. Right here. This is God's word. And that is our ultimate authority. God's word is our ultimate authority. We hold these truths. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And Jesus is the very word of God. And Jesus is revealed to us in God's word. So he is the way, the truth, and the life. 2 Timothy 3, 14-17, we've seen this before. But you must remain faithful to the things you have been taught. You know they are true, for you know you can trust who taught you. You have been taught the Holy Scriptures from childhood, and they have been given you the wisdom to receive salvation that comes by trusting in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is inspired by God and is useful to teach us what is true and to make us realize what is wrong with our lives. Isn't that cool? All Scripture is inspired by God and useful to teach us what is true and to make us realize what is wrong in our lives. It corrects us when we're wrong and teaches us to do what is right. God uses it to prepare and equip his people to do every good work. Where would we be today if it weren't for the guidance of the Scriptures? We believe that the Scriptures contain everything we need for salvation and are completely reliable. We do not think that this is a book of fables. No, this is God's Word. This is how he revealed it to us. The 66 books of the Bible are the Old and the New Testament, and they are the written record of God's work in history. Matter of fact, Pastor Pam and I are currently working through a series in Sunday school called The Story, which outlines this wonderful story of the Old and New Testament of the Bible. The Bible includes the life and teaching of God's Son, Jesus Christ. Because they are inspired by God and infallibly written in their original manuscripts, we look for them as the basis of the doctrine of the Wesleyan Church. And as I mentioned last week, the church does not operate in a vacuum. How has the Wesleyan Church interpreted the Scripture to come up with what we believe? Interpreting Scripture is not always an easy thing. Various religious groups have offered different interpretations for even the simplest of Scripture. And it can be challenging to decide which is correct. There are over 1,500 denominations worldwide. And it's probably much larger than that. Most of those denominations became denominations because they disagreed over a way a particular piece of Scripture was to be interpreted. So that's kind of interesting. So, for example, the Protestant movement, we talked about that Martin Luther, He came up and said that salvation is by grace alone. We believe in the authority of the scriptures. But out of the Protestant movement came two camps. We came up with the Calvinist Reformed camp and the Wesleyan Arminian camp, which should be right there. Cool. Now, I wanted to get into this a little bit just for a few moments before we get. So these are basically the two camps that exist within Christianity. You are either Reformed or Calvinistic, or you are Wesleyan Arminian. That's a lot of big words right there. And you see a lot of big words on the screen right now. Reformed people believe in total depravity. That means they believe there is no way, as we as humans, we are so deep in our sins, we can make no move to God at all. The only way Christ ever even saves us is that he has to regenerate us first, and then we can have faith in him. We as Wesleyans believe a little differently. Yes, we say we are pretty deep in our sins. But we believe in this little thing called prevenient grace. And prevenient grace says God turns the light on just enough so we can say, hey, I want more of that. And he calls us toward salvation. So faith precedes regeneration. They have something called unconditional election. That means God picks and chooses who gets saved, no matter if you're a good person or a bad person, and you have no say in it. We believe in conditional election. What does that mean? Well, that means God has called everyone to salvation, though many whom he has called do not respond. We really believe that. Third one, limited atonement. Limited atonement means that Christ only died for those who he chose, those who are Christians. So Christ's blood does not cover everybody, but only the blood of those he chose. We believe something much, much more grace-filled. We believe that Christ's blood was shed for every person and is available for every person, and it is applied to those who respond to his offer of salvation. Calvinists believe in irresistible grace. That means if God calls you to be saved, you can't resist it. No matter how bad you are, you can't resist it. Well, we believe in grace too. But we say that grace is irresistible. God has given this prevenient grace, this little light that gets turned on, which draws us towards saving grace, but the individual is not forced to respond to God's grace. We are not robots. God is not some micromanager. I really believe that. The last one. You might not have heard this term before, perseverance of the saints, but you've heard this term. Once saved, always saved. Reformed Calvinistic people believe that once you are a Christian, there is nothing that you can do to help you, that you can step out of God's grace. They claim that people who are reprobate never received Christ in the first place. They might have looked, they might have played a good act for a while, but they were never saved in the first place. We do not believe that. We believe what's called conditional security. And I want you, one of the things I'm going to say, because I remember growing up and I think for a long time we believed in, if they believed in unconditional security, we believed in unconditional insecurity. I remember there was a time in my life that if I did something wrong on Wednesday and I didn't get to the altar by Sunday, if I died before I got to the altar on Sunday, I might be going to hell. That's not the way God's grace works. Here's what conditional security means. Once saved, a person will always be saved unless by defiant, continual, and purposeful rebellion they refuse grace and they choose apostasy. Now, you look at that and you say, well, how can Calvinists use the same 66 books as we do? But they have their scriptures that they go to, and we have our scriptures that we go to. So when we come to a fork in the road, we should just take it, as Yogi Berra said. But how do we decide? How do we decide those sticky portions of scripture? Because Calvinists make some very good claims with some of their scriptures. They make some very good claims for those five things. we make some good claims. Well, the grandfather of our movement, John Wesley, came up with four simple principles. He called them the Wesleyan quadrilateral. And the last time I drew this up for you, I drew it up as a baseball diamond, but I think a stool works much better. So bring up that nice little stool. The purple top of the stool is the scripture. Everything is based on scripture. Absolutely everything. This is the way God reveals himself to us, and we insist that every doctrine, which is in this little red book, this is our discipline, all these articles of religion are in this book, but we insist that everything in here is based on scripture. We can understand God's will for us, including the way to be saved from sin, by careful study of the Bible, but we believe that scripture, not the Pope, not tradition, not experience, not reason, is the final authority for testing truth. They can never, those things can never replace God's revelation of Scripture. So there are three legs. The first one is tradition. There is a wealth of wisdom that we can learn from the centuries. The church has existed for 2,000 years, and we can learn from the church's creeds, their hymns, prayers, writing, rituals, art. That's why, as long as I'm your pastor, we will never sing just modern praise and worship songs. And as your pastor, I'm also going to insist that we sing some of the old songs. And when I talk about old songs, I mean songs from the 1500s and the 1600s and the 1700s, especially the great Wesley hymns. There is a ton of theology in the Wesley hymns. Sometimes they're kind of hard to play, though. And I know that I don't like to play them on my guitar because they're tough to play. But I think we need to be singing those old things. We need to be singing all the music. I like that brand new song that I talked to this morning. Man, it comes right down, tells us exactly what we believe. And so I just want to encourage us, especially in the area of hymns, that we need to be singing all of the songs. We need to be singing from hymn number one to hymn number 700 and something. in our hymn book. I really believe. I go to churches sometimes. I go to churches sometimes and they sing all the modern praise and worship stuff. I'm like, well, where's the deep stuff? And so I want you to know, I believe that, and that's not to say there isn't some great new deep stuff being written, because there is, but to just do it all on the modern stuff, I'm not too into that. So we can learn from the church's creeds, hymns, prayers, writing, rituals, art. These traditions give insight into Scripture and how it applies to our lives today. The very fact that something has stood the test of time means that it's probably correct. Most of the heresies that existed right after Jesus left this earth were quashed because of good solid thinking. The fact that an idea is 1,000 or more years old means it should be an important guide for our thinking. That's not to say, because, I mean, remember, Martin Luther broke over the Catholic Church because he said, there's some things that have gotten slipped into your teaching and we need to correct these. So sometimes new things do crop up and they do not, or sometimes even old heresies. You know, even a lot of what we consider New Age teaching is really old teaching, what we used to call the Gnostic teaching. So we need to be careful, because sometimes new ideas might slip into our teaching and they're not really correct. So first leg is tradition, the next leg is experience. Our own life experiences shed light on many of the church's teachings and biblical lessons. And when we compare our experiences with others, it helps us better understand God's saving work. We call that the emotions. So scripture, tradition, emotion, but there's also one more. There's reason. That's here. God gave us a mind for a reason. And so that's so we could think through things. One of the things that I hear so many times is, oh yeah, Christians, they check their minds at the door. No. We as Christians need to be thinking seriously about scripture and what it means. That doesn't mean that there aren't some great mysteries. When I think about the fact that Jesus came as a baby, what we call as the incarnation, the fact that Jesus came to be one of us, that he was fully God and fully human, can you comprehend that? I can't. The fact that Jesus was both, the fact that Jesus raised himself from the dead. Now, there are other people in the scriptures who are raised from the dead, but only one person raised himself from the dead, and that was Jesus. So we do have a creed. We do have a statement of faith, and that is on these pages, and I really thought it would be important, and I'm going to try to do this in 8 minutes. I'm not reading this word for word, by the way. I'm not going to do it. But there are some things, there are some key points that I want to share with you. What do we as Wesleyans believe? Well, we believe in the one living and true God, both holy and loving, eternal, unlimited in power, wisdom, and goodness, the creator and preserver of all things. Within this unity, there are three persons of one essential nature, power and eternity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Later on this year, I'm going to preach a message on the Trinity, because that kind of blows my mind, that God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit are one, but yet they're three distinct persons. That's a great mystery. But we're going to try to unpack that a little later. The Father. We believe that the Father is the source of all that exists, whether in matter or spirit. With the Son and the Holy Spirit, he made man, male and female in his image, and by intention he relates to people as Father, thereby forever declaring his goodwill toward them. In love, he seeks and receives penitent sinners. 3, we believe in Jesus Christ. This statement's going to sound kind of familiar. We believe in Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, truly God and truly man. He died on the cross and was buried to be a sacrifice both for original sin and all human transgressions, and to reconcile us to God. Christ rose bodily from the dead and ascended into heaven, and there intercedes for us at the Father's right hand until he returns to judge all humanity at the last day. That's kind of cool. That's what we believe. We believe in the Holy Spirit, who proceeds from the Father and Son, and is of the same essential nature, majesty, and glory as the Father and the Son, truly and eternally God. We believe in the books of the Old and New Testaments constitute the Holy Scriptures. They are the inspired and infallibly written word of God, fully inerrant in the original manuscripts and superior to all human authority, and have been transmitted to the present without corruption of any essential doctrine. There are people who will tell you that the Bible isn't true, that it's corrupt. Don't believe them. 6, we believe that the two great commandments which require us to love the Lord our God with all of our heart and our neighbors as ourselves summarize the divine laws as they're revealed in the scriptures. 7, we believe that every person is created in the image of God, that human sexuality reflects that image in terms of intimate love, communication, fellowship, subordination of the self to the larger whole, and fulfillment. God's word makes the use of marriage relationship as a supreme metaphor for his relationship with his covenant people and for revealing truth that this relationship is of one God and with one people. And you can see the rest, that one of the things that Wesleyans believe is we believe that marriage is between a man and a woman and it's a monogamous relationship. And we do believe in the sacredness of marriage. We believe that, 8, we believe that humanity's creation in the image of God included the ability to choose between right and wrong, and thus individuals are made morally responsible for their choices. There's a lot more in that. There's a lot more in this one. 9. We believe that through the disobedience of Adam and Eve, sin entered into the world, and all creation suffers its consequences. The effects of sin include disruption of the relationship between God and humanity, deterioration of the natural order of creation, and the exploitation of persons by evil or misguided social system, and the whole creation groans for redemption. And that would be pretty bad news if it weren't for 10. We believe that Christ's offering for himself once and for all through his sufferings and meritorious death on the cross provides the perfect redemption and atonement for the sins of the whole world, both original and actual. There is no other ground of salvation from sin but that alone. Jesus Christ died for our sins. That makes us at one with Jesus Christ again. Repentance and faith. We believe that for men and women to appropriate what God's prevenient grace has made possible, they must voluntarily respond in repentance and faith. The ability comes from God, but the act is the individual's. Repentance is promised by the convicting ministry of the Holy Spirit. It involves a willful change of mind that renounces sin and longs for righteousness, a godly sorrow for and a confession of past sins, proper restitution for wrongdoings, and a resolution to reform the life. Lots of big words in this next one, number 12. We believe that when one repents of personal sins and believes on the Lord Jesus Christ, that at that same moment, a person is justified, made just as if we haven't sinned, regenerated, adopted into the family God, and assured of personal salvation through the witness of the Holy Spirit. Number 13, we believe that although good works cannot save us from our sins or from God's judgment, they are a fruit of faith and follow after regeneration. Number 14, so what happens if a believer sins? We believe that after we have experienced regeneration, it is possible to fall into sin. For in this life there is no height nor strength of holiness from which it is impossible to fall, but by the grace of God, one who has fallen into sin may by true repentance and faith find forgiveness and restoration. Amen? We believe that sanctification is the work of the Holy Spirit by which the child of God is separated from sin unto God and is able to love God with all of the heart and to walk in all of his holy commandments blameless. We believe that the gift of the Spirit is the Holy Spirit himself, and he is desired more than the gifts of the Spirit, which he in his wise counsel bestows upon individual members of the church. 17, we believe in the Christian church is the entire body of Jesus Christ, who is the founder and only head of the church. The church includes both those believers who have gone to be with the Lord and those who remain on earth, having renounced the world, the flesh, and the devil, and having dedicated themselves to the work which Christ committed into his church until he comes. The church on earth is to preach the pure word of God, properly administer the sacraments according to Christ's instructions, and live in obedience to all that Christ commands. We do believe in two sacraments. We believe in water baptism and the Lord's Supper, and they are commanded by Christ and ordained as a means of grace when received through faith. We're to the last page. Number 19. We already heard about this great hope in that song. We believe that the certainty of the personal and imminent return of Christ inspires holy living and zeal for evangelization of the world. Number 20, we believe in the bodily resurrection from the dead of all people. We believe that we will resurrect our physical bodies. Number 21, we believe that the scriptures reveal God is judge of all, and his acts of judgment are based on his omniscience and his eternal justice. Lastly, we believe that the scriptures clearly teach that there is a conscious personal existence after death. The final destiny of each person is determined by God's grace, and that person's response evidenced inevitably by a moral character which results from the individual's personal and volitional choices and not from any arbitrary decree of God. Heaven, with its eternal glory and blessedness of Christ's presence, is the final abode of all those who choose salvation, which God provides through Jesus Christ. But hell, with its everlasting misery and separation from God, is the final abode of those who neglect this great salvation. That's what we believe. That's as much as I could shorten and not take out important stuff. But actually, what's really cool is we actually, in our discipline, there's even a shorter version that we're going to say together. That we're going to do that as we leave this morning. So, no, not that. Go back to the PowerPoint. Let's all stand. There should be a short. There we go.
1 second.
That's it. So this is what we believe. And so as we get ready to leave here this morning, what I want to do is I want to challenge you. If you are a member, you're going to make this as a declaration to say, you know, this is truly what I believe. This is what I believe as a member of McCrae Brook Wesleyan Church. If you are not a member, you've heard all of our core doctrine right there. And if you're not a member and you want to be a member of McCrae Brook Wesleyan Church, I want you to start praying about it. We're going to give you a couple weeks to pray about it so that we can bring you in properly. The board has to do a couple things, and so it's all going to work out pretty perfectly. So you let me know if you're interested in being a member. But here's In summary, here's what we believe. And this is going to be our benediction for this morning. We believe in God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We believe that Jesus Christ the Son suffered in our place on the cross, that he died but rose again, that he now sits at the Father's right hand until he returns to judge every person at that last day. We believe in the Holy Scriptures as the inspired and inerrant Word of God. We believe that by grace of God, every person has the ability and responsibility to choose between right and wrong, and that those who repent of their sin and believe in the Lord Jesus Christ are justified by faith. We believe that God not only counts the believer as righteous, but that he makes such persons righteous, freeing them from sin's dominion at conversion, purifying their hearts by faith, perfecting them in love and entire sanctification, and providing for their growth in grace at every stage of spiritual life, enabling them through the presence and power of the Holy Spirit to live victorious lives. That's what it's all about, my friends. Dear Lord Jesus,